politeness and affection, diminutive cha, use of vocative construction, and limitative lia in Southern Quechua. Hello. In this presentation, we're going to focus on three ways in which speakers of Southern Quechua can modify the way they talk to somebody to express something more affectionate or to express more closeness with the person they are talking to, with the addressee. So these are three forms that are fairly common and very frequently used in these languages. Cha, the diminutive, lia, which means just, and a construction that we call the vocative, which means that you are calling somebody's attention or that you are trying to exhort or talk to that person, you know, so that they pay attention to you. Let's take a look at them. First, the diminutive cha objectively suggests that something is small in size. That is the objective meaning. So for instance, we have wasi, house, and we have wasicha, a little house. However, there is also the very frequent use of cha to indicate that you like somebody, that something is pleasant to you, or that you have some type of affection, some type of affective closeness to that thing. And that is fairly common in Spanish too. When you say the diminutive ito, like amigo, amiguito, it's not that your friend is little, it could be objectively, but also is that you want to talk to that person in a way that is more affectionate. So this affectionate stance can be seen in the word alco, dog, but you have also alcocha, which means doggy, but also little dog. So there is a subjective feeling that you have when you use the word doggy instead of little dog. And that is exactly what cha in Quechua can convey, both the objective and the subjective connotation of the term. Tura, if a woman is talking or is referring to somebody as a brother of her, she's going to say tura for that word. But turacha, that means simply little brother, or also dear brother, hermanito in Spanish. Regarding its position, the suffix cha goes closer, right next to the noun base, to the bare stem of the noun that you're using. So you have the stem alco, which means dog. Stem is the technical term for the word without the suffixes. Okay, so alco, dog, but you say alcocuna, dogs, but you have to say alcochacuna, little dogs or doggies. So you get the point here is that the distribution of the suffixes is going to make cha all the way to the left next to the stem, next to the base of the noun base. And then after that, you can put kuna or you could put other suffixes. Alcocha, alcochai, my little dog. Alcochai kuna, my little dogs. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. The vocative construction is used when you want to call somebody's attention. So the vocative is the form that the noun takes when you use it to call this person. So for instance, when you say, Mary, are you there? Mary is the vocative and you is the subject. But if you say, Mary is my sister, then Mary is the subject. So pretty much whenever we say a noun and then we add a little pause, we are using that noun to call somebody's attention, to call that person's name, or to call that person something that they may react to. To do this in Quechua, we need to add stress in the final vowel of the word, of the noun, and then we follow that with the possessive form for the first person, like saying my something. So this is the combination that you need to use. And remember that normally, virtually every noun in Quechua, or every word in Quechua, is stressed in the syllable before the last one. So because you are using this vocative in a special way to call somebody to call somebody's attention, you are going to change the stress to the last syllable. And that means mark with the stress the final vowel in the word. We can see this here. Tai tai. In this form, in the first one that I'm about to say, or that you're seeing right now, the noun tai tai is not a vocative. It's just a regular noun that is the subject of the sentence. So you have Taytay Peru Pitian, Taytay Peru Pitian, my father lives in Peru. Notice how it's Taytay, Taytay, not Taytay, Taytay Peru Pitian. However, if you say something like Taytay Imainalia, that means father, how are you? Or sir, because as you should remember, Taita is the term of respect that we use with somebody who is older than us, old enough to be our father, or you want to be respectful towards that person, so you call him Taita, father. And in this case, Taytay Imainalia, sir, how are you? And for a woman, you would use mama, and then you would say in this case, Mamay Imainalia, ma'am, how are you? Or mother of mine, literally. So in the picture, you can see this guy who is looking at, you know, is distracted, and then somebody does this, Yao Turay. And then the guy looks, you know, because somebody called him Turay. Hey, friend, Tura, brother of a woman. So a woman is talking in this case and calls him Yao Turay, Yao, hey. But they must be acquainted with each other. It's informal to call somebody using Yao. You don't use that with an unknown, somebody you're not acquainted with, because that could be considered rude. So you have to watch out for that. More examples of the use of the noun as a subject and a noun as a vocative. We have here Masi Ingenierum. Masi Ingenierum. Masi, mate, friend. My friend is an engineer. But Masi. My mantatas kanki, Masi, my mantatas kanki. Where are you from, my friend? Masi. And you can see how the Y at the end means my. Literally, what you're saying is friend of mine, or my friend, where are you from? My mantatas kanki. To make things a little bit more complicated or more affectionate, depending how you want to look at it, we can throw around cha and ya in the word that we're using as a vocative to stress the affection or the closeness that we feel towards the person we are calling. So you could say something like taitachai uyariyuai, taitachai uyariyuai, which is my little father, padrecito, señorcito in Spanish, little sir, affectionate. Used, affectionately used. My little father, sir, listen to me. Uyariyuai, that's a command. Or you could say, mamalyai, pitah kanki. Mamalyai, pitah kanki. My dear ma'am, mother of my dear mother, who are you? So in that case, of course, if you are gonna say mother, for logical reason, you know, it makes sense that this person is not your real mom, you're just addressing that woman as ma'am, which is the more polite way of doing that. Notice how for taitachai and mamalyai, we are still keeping the rule that adds the stress to the last vowel in the word. And of course, you need to remember this, the Y in the end, mamalyai, taitalyai, or taitachai, that Y at the end is never considered a vowel in Quechua. That is a very important rule for pronunciation. So it is good that you keep, you know, this in mind. A Y or a W are not vowels. They are always considered as consonants. So you are not saying taitachai. No, you're saying taitachai, not mamalyai. No, mamalyai. Those are different things, okay? Regarding the limitative suffix lia, what you can see is that it means just or only. And as this illustration shows you to the right, what you have is singling somebody out. That is the main meaning of that suffix. So when you say something like sapalian, that means sapa, single, alone. Sapalian, just alone. Sapalian, just him alone. That's what you're saying in that case. So by singling somebody out, by specifying that this is just the thing that we want, we can use that word, we've been using that, you know, to with interrogative words too, but we can say something like nokalia, nokalia, just me, or walech, fine, walechlia, just fine, or only fine. It's extremely common, extremely productive in Quechua to use that. The nature of lia is that of an independent suffix, and that means that you can use lia with nouns, but also with verbs. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples of how this can happen. So you can have runalia kani, I am just a person. If you say runakani, that means I am a person. But runalia kani, I am just a person, I'm only a person. On the other hand, you can use it also with a verb. So you have liankai, to work, and you can say something like urbanapi liankan, he works in Urbana, but you could also say urbanapi liankayan, he only works in Urbana. Interestingly, if you put lia with the verb, then what you are stressing is that he only works in Urbana and he doesn't live there or he doesn't do anything else there. It is working, the only thing he does. So this is very important in Quechua. The place where you put those independent suffixes makes a big difference, well, a subtle difference, let's be more precise, a subtle difference in what you're trying to convey. So if you say urbanaliapi, that means just in Urbana, just in Urbana, not somewhere else, just in Urbana. But if I say liankalian, he only works, that means working is all he does, not anything else. As I mentioned before, lia is commonly and frequently used with interrogative words, with questions, like the first example here, imainatah kashanki, how are you, but imainaliatah kashanki, which is how are you, I am just asking, or how are you, if I may ask. Mailiamantatah, my mantatah, that's the one that we've been using more often, my mantatah, where is she from? My mangliatatah, or excuse me, my liamantatah, or where is she from, if I may ask. So the use of lia is pretty much making your question more restricted. It is, I am just doing this, I'm only asking in some way, and that is perceived in Quechua as a politeness strategy. So you want to soften the way you ask a question or you give a command. Command is something that we'll be looking at later, so I'm just focusing here on the question. And if you're curious about this, the distribution is also important. The form manta, that you can see here, manta, is detached or is broken with the use of lia. So instead of having my manta, you have my lia manta. So lia in this case goes closer to the stem, goes closer to the word, to the base word. Let's talk about that right now. So regarding its position, we're gonna see how the closest you put lia to the stem, it produces a subjective, more polite, more endearment meaning. And the farther away you put lia with respect to the stem, the meaning is going to be more objective. Let's focus just on the nouns and the associated suffixes, such as the plural kuna and the possessive y, e, to say my, and the diminutive cha, to see how you can distribute these suffixes in relation to lia. As I mentioned, the closer you put lia to the noun base, it has the more subjective the value is going to be. However, it must go after cha. So if you're going to use lia for a subjective value and you also are using cha, cha goes before lia. And then you have something like mamalia, which means just a mother, or mom, because it's right next to the stem. It's right next to the stem. It's right next to the base, to the noun, to the basis of the noun. Mamalia, just a mother, but also mom. Okay, signals affection. But you could say mamaliai, or excuse me, mamaliai, mamaliai, which means just my mom or my dear mom. But this is not a vocative. Mamaliai has the stress in the normal position for a Quechua word, the one before the last syllable. So mamaliai, mamaliai. If we want to make this into a vocative, it could be mamai. But if you keep lia, it's going to be mamaliai, mamaliai. And in that, and in that case, it means my dear mom. If you have cha, then cha is going to be before lia, and because of the use of cha, what you are talking about is going to be perceived as a vocative that is strongly affectionate and respectful. So mama chaliai, mama chaliai, mama chaliai, my dear mom, my dear ma'am, madrecita mía in Spanish, mama chaliai, imainatas kashanki. Mama chaliai, imainatas kashanki. My dear mom, my dear ma'am, how are you? So what we're looking at here is that the combination of cha and ya gives a much stronger sense of affection towards the person you are talking to when you use the vocative. But also on its own, lia can have a meaning that is subjective when you have it close to the stem. On the other hand, if you put lia towards the end of the noun or at the end of the noun, following the possessive or following the plural, so we're using it at the end, then it is clear to the Quechua speaker that you are just trying to say something like only this or just this. There is not a clear subjective intention, like affectionate stance or some type of deference towards the person you're talking to. It is just that person that you're talking about. So, mamanya, just his mom. Mamanya, mamaya, just my mom. So you say mamaya. Mamanya, the N is the third person, his, her. Mamanya, just her mom. But that does not mean his dear mom or her dear mom. Okay? It only means just his mom, nobody else. If you say mamaikikunalia, mamaikikunalia, that means mamaiki, your mom, mamaikuna in this case is the mothers of yours, like you guys as moms. So mamaikikunalia, just your mothers, not your dear mothers. Okay, you're talking to several people, like you're addressing them, and then you say, hey, mamaikikunalia, ari mamaikikulai, mamaikikunalia hamushan, you're just your mom, just your mothers are coming, hamushan. Finally, a little practice with this. Let's take a minute so that you could take a look at them and see if you can do it. You can pause the video. You have these examples here. My little brother, my little sister, dear aunts, my dear mom lives in Pittsburgh, my dear little uncle, a little cat, my dear little cat, just a little cat. So where are you from, if I may ask, my dear sir? So those are, all of those are forms that we just studied. So take your time, pause your video, and then see what you can tell me. So let's take a look at the answers. My little brother is going to be waukechai. Waukechai, if you are doing it the vocative, waukechai. Or waukechai, if you are just using it as a subject. Okay, waukechai with the stress. Waukechai, if you're saying my little brother. Waukechai, Champagne Pitian, my little brother lives in Champagne. Or in my case, Waukechai Lima Pitian, my brother, my little brother, but he's not little anymore, he lives in Lima. My little sister, Panichai, if you are talking about her, and Panichai, if that's the vocative, if you are calling her, Panichai. Of course, in this case, it's a man, the one who is talking, okay? If it were a woman, she has to say Nyanyachai, if she's talking about that person, Nyanyachai Koskopitian, my little sister lives in Cusco. But Panichai, if you are calling her, Panichai Imainalian, a woman talking to another woman, Panichai Imainalian, little sister of mine, my sister, how are you? It's everybody, when you talk to somebody who is around your same age, you have to use brother or sister for that person, okay? Dear aunts, well, you can use the Spanish law, which is fairly common nowadays, tia, and you can say tia yacuna, tia yacuna, tia lia, tia yacuna, tia yacuna, or Ipa Liacuna. Ipa, an older word that is still, you know, in use by some people, elderly people at this point, Ipa, aunt. So Ipa Liacuna, dear aunts. So notice how Lia is closer to the tia or closer to Ipa, and that brings the subjective connotation of the use of Lia. His dear mom lives in Pittsburgh. Mamalian, Pittsburgh Pitian. Mamalian, Pittsburgh Pitian. Here you can see how Lia again is closer to mama, just to make sure that it means something special, something more affectionate. If it were the other way around, it would be Mamanlia, just his mom, just her mom, Mamanlia. Notice how Lia has moved. Then, my dear little uncle, as a vocative, Tiyu Chalyai, my dear little uncle. A little cat, Michicha, there is nothing to add there, Michicha, or Misicha, depending if you are in Ayacucho, if you are using the Chanca variety, it's going to be Misi, Misicha. My dear little cat, Michichalyai, Michichalyai. Just a little cat, Michichalia. Just a little cat, Michichalia. Once again, Lia towards the end or at the end indicates an objective perspective. So this is just a little cat. No Michiliacha, which would have been a little dear little cat. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, Michichalia. Always the Lia has to go after cha. Sorry about my confusion there. And finally, so where are you from, if I may ask, my dear sir? Like all of that convoluted form. In Quechua, it's fairly straightforward to say, with the same effect. May liamantata taita chalyai. May liamanta. May liamantata. May liamantata taita chalyai. We already saw how tah is used to soften the question, adding some type of, so where are you from? Like you're following up a conversation. So my lia adds this, I am just asking, I am being very polite asking you, my liamantatah, taita chalyai. And then you have cha, lia, cha always before lia, and then the stress in the last vowel, and then the possessive for the first person, which means, so where are you from, if I may ask, my dear sir? Well, I hope that this has helped you to understand how to be more polite when you're asking questions, when you're referring to people in Quechua. And remember, the word yao, hey, it's used best with people who you are acquainted with, friends, people on your same age group. Don't use that with somebody who is older or somebody who you are not familiar with, because they could consider that rude. Okay? Thank you very much for your attention, and let's see you to Tupananchis Kamaya.